Well, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
And Jazakallah, and you know, shukran and many thanks to the IIIT, you know, International Institute of Islamic Thought, for hosting me here very kindly. And many thanks to all of you for coming here, you know, on an evening, you know, spending your time. I remember meeting IIIT many years ago. We had a, I think that was a lunch, and today I was also graciously invited for dinner, and I look forward to that and to learn more. And I'm really glad that there's an institution in the US which is really thinking about issues of the Muslim world and producing material that Muslims can use as an intellectual, you know, basis for dealing with some of the modern challenges. I should just say that. Well, people might have a few questions. First of all, why did you write a book like this? Why there's a cover of a face of Jesus, you know, supposedly face of Jesus, you know, drawing on it. I mean, that might be a Muslim question. And why do you mean by the king of the Jews becoming a prophet of Muslims? Why did that mean? Let me first say a few things about these, then I'll get into some of the ideas in my book. One reason I wrote a book about this is that I have been thinking about this big issue of theological matters between Christianity and Islam for 10, 15 years, so it's a long story there. But what provoked this particular book was another book by a more famous Muslim writer, Reza Aslan. You know, you've probably heard Reza Aslan, you probably know him, he's on TV very often. He's a great guy, he's been, I think, successful as a Muslim public intellectual and has done a good job in the US. But Reza wrote a book named Zealot, which became very popular. It came out in 2014, if I'm not wrong. And the book was successful, a book written by a Muslim author, so it had that image. But the book depicted Jesus, Isa alayhi salam, as a Jewish revolutionary against Roman, you know, rule. You would think that Jesus was a guerrilla leader, you know, fighting the Roman Empire, and that's why he was crucified. So that was, it was a book written by a Muslim author, but it was not a book written from an Islamic perspective. It was not saying anything about the Islamic perspective on Jesus. It was just looking at Jesus from a historical point of view, and it was choosing one of the different historical theses about Jesus. Because who Jesus really is a big issue, and there are different historical views about this. There is a concept called historical Jesus, like who he was really, besides the Christian dogma. So that has been discussed by scholars since the 19th century. And some people say, oh, he was a revolutionary, he was a fighter against Rome, a zealot, like a really religious fundamentalist militant of his time. That's why he was crucified. So that's one argument. And Reza, you know, defended an argument. When I read that, I said, this is a nicely written book, but I don't agree with it, actually. That's not the Jesus I believe in the Quran. That's not the Jesus I even think, you know, is, from the historical point of view, is actually a convincing one. So I said, maybe there should be a book about Jesus from the Muslim point of view. And which brought me to this work. And when I got into that idea, I also realized, well, there are some books about actually explaining what Jesus is according to Islam, who Jesus is according to the Quran. There are a few good books actually published over the years. I read all of those, of course. But I wanted to do something else. I wanted to first explain how Islam defines Jesus and Mary, his mother. And how does this resonate with different branches of Christianity? Because there are, as you pointed out, there's a spectrum within early Christianity about the nature of Jesus, who he was, what he was actually teaching. And there are some branches of early Christianity that became heretical over time, according to mainstream, but whose beliefs are actually very similar to what Islam has been teaching. And that is an interesting connection I thought has to be underlined, you know, and emphasized a little bit. So that book is partly about that. Why there's a painting of Jesus? Well, I don't think we Muslims should do make paintings of the prophets, but I don't think it is. I think it was in early Islam banned to stop idolatry. You know, there's a big concern in Islam about a prophet or any human being turning into an idol. So I think there's a maqasid behind that injunction. And I think hey, Christians use the imagery of Jesus. I personally don't find it offensive. So when the publisher wants to use the picture, I didn't find it offensive. If there are Muslims who find it offensive, I will apologize for them. And, you know, but that's my perspective. And okay, what's the title says? The Islamic Jesus, how the King of the Jews became a prophet of the Muslims. Some people say, what do you mean, King of the Jews? Well, the King of the Jews is a concept coming from the New Testament, the Gospels. According to the Gospels, when the fourth Gospel, when Jesus was crucified, again, according to the Gospels, the Roman governor, Pilate, wrote on the cross, the King of the Jews. And then some Jewish elders of the time said, don't say the King of the Jews. Say, this man said, I am the King of the Jews. And Pilate said, I have written what I have written. I don't care about those details. So this idea of King of the Jews is coming from the New Testament. And of course, what does it mean? I mean, Jesus is a prophet. What is this king? Well, Jesus is defined in the Quran as a prophet, but also as the Messiah, Al-Masih. Actually, the Quran repeatedly, 11 times, calls him the Messiah. Sometimes it doesn't even use the words. It says just Messiah, son of Mary. So the concept of Messiah is coming from Judaism. Jews had this notion of Messiah. And it is actually very parallel to what we have in the Islamic tradition as the Mahdi. Like a savior who will come towards the end of times and who will save Muslims from oppression, from ignorance, and, you know, uplift the ummah. So in Islam, there's a concept of Mahdi. Some Muslim scholars think Mahdi is a, you know, like a matter of belief. Some scholars think it's not. I'm of the latter opinion, but anyway, there's that notion in Islam, in Islamic tradition, let's say. Not in the Quran, but in Islamic tradition. Well, the Messiah was a concept like that in Judaism, and Jews were waiting a Messiah who will come and save them, who will come and, you know, save them from all the oppression they are going under Rome, and it was the savior that they were waiting. So the Quran calls Jesus Messiah, and Messiah, according to Jews, was a prophet, but also a king, a political ruler who would save the Jews. So the concept of King of the Jews is actually coming from the Christian tradition, and it actually coming from the Jewish tradition as well, because that's what was Messiah meant. And I think the Quran, by defining Jesus as Messiah, Al-Masih, is, you know, confirming that Jesus was the Messiah that the Jews were waiting. But Jews didn't accept him. So there's a disagreement between Islam and there with Judaism. And Christianity accepted him, but defined Messiah as God incarnate, which Muslims, again, don't accept. So we are taking a middle position in that interesting dichotomy. So this is just a few basic ideas, but I'll really get into why I wrote this book and what is the connection I mean when I mean some heretical sects of Christianity and Islam. Actually, the story, which I begin in the introduction, which I relate in the introduction chapter, began in early 2000s in Istanbul. I'm from Istanbul. Probably many of you have visited, you know, that city. It's crowded and a lot of traffic, but beautiful city. And in early 2000s, you know, I was still, like, I was a young, aspiring Muslim writer. You know, I hadn't published this much, but I wanted to. And I was walking in Istiklal Street, the busiest street in Istanbul, and, like, I saw different, you know, that street is always full of communists who give you pamphlets and, you know, Kurds and some activists. A young Christian missionary gave me a book, and I said, what is this? And oh, that's the Gospel, the Injil, you know, the New Testament. So they presented me this book, the New Testament, the Christian's Bible, the, you know, the New Testament part of the Bible. And I thanked it, and, you know, I went at night and I read it. And I was impressed, you know, because I didn't read the, I mean, I knew Islamic sources, but I hadn't read the Christian sources at the time. I was impressed. I admired many things I read, but of course I disagreed with many things I read as well. Because in the New Testament, there are chapters that relate Jesus speaking to Jews, calling them to godliness, calling them to piety, calling them to sincerity, and, you know, criticizing, you know, sometimes hypocritical attitudes you find in the name of religion. Those teachings appealed to me a lot. I said, this is wonderful. It's very moving and inspiring. But then there are teachings like Jesus was God incarnate. He was the Son of God. which are concepts that we Muslims, you know, do not accept. So I started to selectively read the New Testament. And actually, I explained in the introduction, at some point I started to use pens. If I love the chapter or passage or word, I underline with blue. And if I didn't like something, I underline with red. I said, this doesn't go. You know, this is not halal. Jesus, Son of God, died for our sins and crucified, and you know, that doesn't go for us. You know, and I've read the New Testament whole, like, for a long time, and I realized that in most of the Gospels, it's all blue. You know, I agree with most of the things. But in the earliest Gospel, there's more blue than red. The earliest one is the one that I agree most. The earliest one is Mark, which is the shortest, and which has less theology, Christian theology in it. The later you go in time, you know, you come to the fourth Gospel, which, you know, deifies Jesus more than the other one. So there are things that I don't agree. The letters of Paul, which create one third of almost the New Testament, it has a lot of red things in it. So I said, okay, I don't really agree with this. That doesn't go well with me. But towards the end, I read another letter or epistle, you know, they're called letters or epistles in the New Testament. And I said, this is wonderful. It's all blue. There's nothing red. I don't disagree with anything in this. This is like the Quran. Like, it's like Risale-i-Nur. You know, I don't know if you know the Turkish tradition. Like, it's wonderful. What is this? It was the letter of James. It's titled the letter of James. And I read this, like I said, who's this James? Like, it's really good. Like, there's no problem with this. Who was James? And I made some research and I realized, oh, James was the brother of Jesus, according to Christian sources. And of course you can say, how James can be brother? I mean, Jesus, you know, without a father. Yes, but according to Christian sources, according to New Testament, Mary, after giving birth to Jesus, actually, even while she was pregnant, she married to a man named Joseph. So after Jesus, Mary had a few more children. So the eldest child was James, or Yaqub, you know, called in Arabic. So in English it's called James, so Yaqub in Arabic. Yaakov in Hebrew original. So that was actually after Jesus, the most important, you know, male child of the family. And the more I digged this letter of James, I realized that James was actually a very important figure in early Christianity. Because when actually Jesus passed away, the leadership of the community was taken by James. James became the leader, the caliph, if you will. Like, you know, after Prophet Muhammad, you have Abu Bakr. James became the leader of the early Christian community. But today, in Christianity, James is not very famous. Some Christians ask James, they don't know even who he is. And the letter of James exists in the New Testament. However, it was disputed. Some early Christian fathers did not want to include in the New Testament. It ultimately got included. Later, some Protestants, for example, Martin Luther said, this is a horrible epistle, it should be thrown out from the New Testament. They want to delete it from the New Testament. And when you dig more into this, you see this interesting discussion within Christianity about the gap between James and his teaching, and Paul and his teaching. The James way and the Paul way. The Jamesian way or the Paulian way. Now, the more I learned about this, I said, there's something really interesting here. What's going on? Like, there's something in early Christianity that sounds very much like what I believe in as a Muslim, but it didn't define mainstream. How did this happen? Well, the book tells you that story, but I will, you know, and I won't tell you every detail, so you can buy the book and read the details more. But here is the summary of what happened. When Jesus passed away, and of course there are different opinions about that. Christians think he was crucified and he was, you know, resurrected 3 days later, he was taken to heaven. If you ask look at Islamic sources, generally he was saved from crucifixion, but still he was taken to heaven. So, like, or some Muslim would say he just died naturally, and you know how the Quran describes his death is open to interpretation. But anyway, after his passing away, let's say after his leaving the earth, indeed Christian sources accept that the leader of the community after him was James, Yaqub, and James and other early followers of Jesus, they had a very important character. They were all Jews. They were all Jewish. Now, what does this mean? This means that when they heard the term Messiah, they understood it in the Jewish sense. They said, according to Judaism, Messiah is not God. Messiah is someone like the Mahdi. He's a prophet and a leader who will come and save Jews from their trouble. So, and also, Jews did not think that when the Messiah comes, the halakha, the religious law, will be abandoned. They did not think that, you know, Jews will start to eat pork without any problem. They did not think that circumcision will be gone. They just thought that Jesus was the Messiah, God sent to us. So they accepted Jesus as the Messiah. From that, they departed from other Jews. But they did not begin to see Jesus as a divine figure. And that is basically accepted by most scholars who have looked into the history, issue of historical Jesus. How do we know this? Because they are called Jewish Christians. And Jewish Christians, because they were Jews who accepted Jesus as the Messiah. So they Jesus didn't say anything about abolishing the law, about abolishing the halakha. He criticized Jews for sometimes being hypocritical about it or being too rigid about it, but he didn't abolish the law. So they just kept observing Jewish rituals, the Saturday, you know, the Sabbath, but they accepted Jesus. So this was the actually early Christian community. It was a sect within Judaism. These were pious Jews, very religious. You can read it in the Book of Acts, in the, you know, in the Gospels, who just said Jesus is the prophet and the Messiah that we were waiting. That's the only difference between them and other Jews. However, then a different character appears in the scene, and that is Paul. Paul, who's actually the real builder of the Christianity that we know today. Who was Paul? Was he one of the disciples of Jesus? No. There were 12 important disciples of Jesus, including Peter, and James was not one of the 12. He was actually about the 12 because he was just the brother of Jesus who took leadership of the community. But they are known in Christian history as the Jerusalem church, you know, because after Jesus they continued in Jerusalem. Paul had nothing to do with these people. Paul was actually an opponent of this Jewish sect called, you know, the Christians. He was a traditional Jew who opposed the Christians, who actually joined the persecution of Christians. But at some point, after a few years after Jesus' death, Paul, according to his own narration, he was actually going from Jerusalem to Damascus. On the way to Damascus, he had a vision. He saw a miracle. He was on his horse, there was some light, he fell from his horse, and he saw Jesus in the sky, and Jesus said, "Paul, Paul, why are you persecuting me?" And Paul said, "Who are you?" And he said, "I'm Jesus that you're persecuting." And then Paul said, "Okay, I see the light. Jesus is the one. Jesus is the one that we wanted away." Then, though, Paul spends 3 years in the desert somewhere, in Arabia, he says, which is probably Syria, without seeing other disciples. And after those 3 years, he says, comes to Jerusalem, he says, "I'm a disciple of Jesus too." And we learn this again from the New Testament. He goes to James to get his blessing, because James is the leader. And Paul says, "Jesus appeared to me, you know, from the sky and in the sight, and, you know, I'm a disciple." They say, "Okay, you know, that's good." And he says, "I want to take the message of Jesus to Gentiles, to non-Jews, to Romans, to Greeks." And we all know this from Paul's own reporting, because we don't know what the James people wrote, because we don't have their text. So Paul says ultimately they blessed him, that Paul went to start preaching Jesus to the Gentiles, to the non-Jews, to the Romans. And he went for several years, like 7 years according to most calculations, the first trip. But then, some people from Jerusalem came and warned some of the people that Paul was talking to and said, he's preaching a wrong gospel, don't listen to him. Paul complains from the emissaries sent by James. So there's a tension between Paul and James. So what is that tension? When you read the New Testament, the first impression is that Paul is telling Gentiles that they don't need to observe the law. They can eat pork, they don't need to be circumcised, they don't need to follow anything, just believe in Jesus and be saved. That became Paul's message. For James and other followers of Jesus, this was shocking, like, because they all follow the halakha, or we would call sharia. I mean, they certainly follow practices. So there's a tension, and actually you can see that tension in the Paul's letter called Galatians. There, Paul goes there and he brings Gentile believers of Jesus and Jewish believers of Jesus in the same table. They eat all together, which is a problem for Jews because they normally don't eat with Gentiles because their food is haram, you know, using the Islamic language here. And it becomes an issue. So Peter actually joins that, but then again, emissaries from James come and warn that you shouldn't do this. And Paul is so angry at this. You can see this in the letters. So Paul goes back and ultimately they make a decision, and James says, okay, Gentiles don't have to obey everything, but they should still obey these laws. So they become the laws of Christianity. But there's this tension between Paul and James that you see in the letters of Paul. And this is all very clear. I mean, this is all in the New Testament. How do you interpret this? Well, traditional Christian scholars would say, yes, there was some disagreement, but ultimately a middle ground was founded. So Paul was blessed by James, and Paul continued the mission among Gentiles, and James became the leader of, still, the leader of Jewish Christians. And Paul brought Jesus to non-Jews, and James was the leader of the Jewish Christian sect. That is one interpretation. But since the 19th century, especially scholars in Germany, in Tübingen theological schools, had done a lot of, you know, rereading of this. Some of them think that actually the tension was bigger, and the New Testament doesn't really display the full tension. There was a bigger tension there. That's one argument. Now, what is even more interesting is that in the year 70, there was a big Roman anti-Roman rebellion against the Roman Empire among Jews in year 66. And at the end of that, in the year 70, Jerusalem is destroyed by Romans. So Jews are purged out of Jerusalem. They have to flee to four corners of the world. So begins the big centuries of, you know, Jewish exile, diaspora. James gets killed before that. James becomes a martyr. And after that, Romans also send all Jews out. So these Jewish Christians are sent out of Jerusalem too. Some die. They actually become an extinct group because most Jews suffer, they suffer as well. They are within Judaism. So we don't have much trace of that early Jewish Christian sect in the first century. After year 70, they disappear. However, when you read Christian church fathers in the second and third century, they still speak of these heretics who are trying to be both Jewish and Christian, and they don't get who Jesus really was. They, for example, speak of a group called the Ebionites. They say there's a group called Ebionites. They're Jewish, and they say they believe in Jesus, but they don't believe Jesus properly. They insist that Jesus was a man, not God. They still observe the Jewish law. They still, you know, observe the Jewish practices, the Sabbath and everything. But they deny that Jesus was God incarnate. So these people become the heretics of Christianity. And this Ebionite controversy goes on for a few centuries. Many church fathers, Eusebius, like different ones, they speak about the heresy of the Ebionites. It's very clear. And when you read Ebionites from a Muslim point of view, you say, these are us. I mean, everything described about the Ebionites sounds very much like what we believe in, you know, as Muslims. Now, this is not a totally unknown story, but it's mostly neglected, so not everybody knows it, so I got into these issues in the book. But one more thing. Of course, some Western scholars noticed this. Like, oh, there's an interesting parallelism between the heretical Christian sect called Jewish Christianity and Islam. That's why some of them, like, it began in Germany again. Germans have done a lot of theological work in the past two centuries. So some of them said, maybe Muhammad, they don't call him a prophet, of course, but sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They said Muhammad maybe learned from the Jewish Christians. So he got the theology from them. So there is a whole Orientalist literature about whether Jewish Christianity might have survived in 7th century Arabia, and whether Prophet Muhammad might have heard their doctrines, because their doctrines are exactly what the Quran is saying about Jesus. So that's actually big scholarly discussion. It began with Adolf Harnack in 19th century. Another guy, Hans Chaim Schoeps, continued. Recently, the person who wrote about this recently passed away a few years ago, Patricia Crone, the big Orientalist, you know, who's trying to always find a historical, you know, source for Islam. Now, these scholars are, to me, onto something. They realize that there is a theological continuation between the Jewish Christians and Islam. There is a theological parallelism. But they can't establish a historical connection. Like, there's no evidence that Jewish Christians existed in 7th century Arabia and Prophet Muhammad could have learned from them. The latest, you know, account we have is from the 5th century and in around Jerusalem. So when you, from that to go to 7th century Arabia, you have two centuries of gap. Of course, there could be secret Jewish Christians who were hiding, but you know, that's speculation, that's not history. So there is so much effort to try to show that maybe a Jewish Christian sect existed, but you cannot prove that. There's no evidence for that. So I have a chapter in the book called The Missing Link. Mm-hmm. And I'm saying, I mean, these scholars who notice the connection, and it includes Hans Küng, for example, the great living theologian, he says, the Jewish Christianity-Islam connection is fascinating. He says, this must be investigated. And a lot of people did. But they show the historical connection, theological connection, the doctrinal connection. They can establish a historical connection. And what should we say then? If there's no historical connection. Well, I have my, of course, theological predispositions, but I took a comment from a US scholar from University of Nebraska. He's one rare person who really thought very carefully about this. What was his name? He's in the book. But he says that it is a bias to think that there should always be a historical connection. Sometimes, a theology can be reborn. He calls this the archetype, the theological archetype. Something which is there can be reborn two centuries later without a historical connection. Now, archetype is the philosophical name to which I would call revelation. But without any historical connection, without Prophet Muhammad really learning from somebody, but that theology got reborn onto him, he calls it an archetype. I would call revelation, but that's how Muslims would see it. So the book, in part, gets into this interesting Jewish Christianity and Islam connection. I then get into what the Quran actually narrates about Mary and Jesus, and I also look at how do they resonate with Christian sources. Because there are some parallels between the Quranic account of the Gospels, the Quranic account of the birth of Jesus and Mary and Jesus' miracles, but there are some differences too. For example, the Quran says Jesus, Isa alayhi salam, gave life to clay birds. He made birds out of clay and, you know, said into them, breathed into them, and those birds fly. Now, if you tell this to a Christian today, like Christian in the US, they will say, what is this? We never heard that. Where does this come from? But if you read an apocryphal gospel called the Gospel of Apocryphal Matthew, which is not included in the New Testament, you read it there. That exists in that apocryphal gospel. Of course, Orientalists saw this and says, oh, then Muhammad must have learned from those. So there's all these kind of different ways of looking into this. But from my perspective, it confirms to me that what the Quran was saying was present in some Christian sources as well, which didn't make itself to the New Testament. There is one very interesting discovery that was really striking for me, and that's about the birth of Jesus. The birth of Jesus is something that the Quran really gives great emphasis, that he was born without the father. In that sense, it is very similar to actually the Christian understanding. Of course, the virgin birth, the fact that Jesus was born without the father, according to Islam, doesn't make Jesus divine. Christians think that when there's a virgin birth, the father becomes God, so they jump from that to this. The Quran says no. However, there's a interesting detail. It's this. Probably you live in the U.S., you see all these Christian, you know, traditions in America. And Christians believe that Jesus was born in Bethlehem in a barn, right? In a stable, they say. Or in an inn, you know, there are different ways to interpret the word, but he was born in a place, either a barn or a stable or an inn. So he was born in the city of Bethlehem, and in a city. Well, little town, obviously, but the Quran says something different. The Quran says Mary had birth pains. She withdrew herself to a distant place, and she went under a palm tree. And she was alone under the palm tree, and she ate from the dates. And God created a miraculous spring under her feet, and she drank from the water, and that became a blessing on her. So she gave birth alone under a palm tree. Now that is a Quranic account. In Surah Al Imran, it's very explained. And Surah Al Maryam and Al Imran both accounts, but I think one of them narrates that. This doesn't write in the New Testament, like Mary giving birth under a palm tree. What is that? I mean, if you tell to Christians, they're saying, we don't know, what is it? In 1990s, an archaeological discovery was made in Israel. Israelis were digging, were building a road between Jerusalem and Bethlehem, which is 5 kilometers, very short distance. They were making a road construction, so they were digging. They found, and they came across accidentally, an old Byzantine church called the Church of the Katisma of Theotokos, which means the seat of the God-bearer. Now, God-bearer, or Theotokos in Latin, is the name given to Mary in Catholics because they thought Jesus was God, so she was carrying God in her womb. So that's the picture we don't accept, but that's how Christians called Mary, some Christians called Mary. The Protestants didn't go that way, but Catholics emphasize. The thing is, so this is a church dedicated to Mary, the Church of Mary, right? So Mary is important for this church. And when the archaeologists dig the church, they found that in the church's floor there are mosaics. And there's only one big mosaic, actually, and that's a palm tree with dates on it. So the Quran says Mary gave birth under a palm tree, and you have a Byzantine church which says this is the seat of Mary, this is the place of Mary, and under the mosaics, there's only one big mosaic, it's a palm tree with dates. So there's a connection. So what the Quran is saying has some correspondence in Christian tradition. The scholar who discovered this and wrote about this, of course, says how Muhammad might have heard this, and you know, he's trying to find the other way around. But you can look from the other way around, saying that the Quran's story is actually has a historical foundation here. So my book includes those kind of connections, and I put myself as a perspective as a Muslim, but I'm saying, well, people can understand in different ways, but here are the interesting theological connections we have. And I'm basically emphasizing that Islam's understanding about Jesus is not that alien to Christianity. Within Christianity, that idea of Jesus not being God, but a chosen person by God, was there in the very beginning, and it was reborn in the Protestant Reformation, by the way. During the Protestant Reformation, when church dogma was questioned, you know, you had, you know, Martin Luther and, you know, Calvin. There was another Protestant reformer who didn't become very successful because he was killed by being burned at the stake. His name was Servetus. Michel Servetus, he was Spanish. He was burned in Switzerland at stake. I mean, they tied him to the stake, they put wood under his, and they burned him. So Christians were not always very liberal, you know. I mean, and throughout history, there were times that they were burning people at stakes. Calvin actually ordered that the wood should be green, so he suffers more. Calvin ordered, so he was the... this Servetus he was a Protestant, he was a believer in Christ, he was a Christian, no doubt about that. But he read the Quran, and he found it fascinating, because he did not really believe in Trinity. I mean, he believed, he called Jesus Son of God, but for him, that didn't make Jesus divine. That means he's a person really chosen and uplifted by God. So the Son of God became a metaphorical term, which actually is the origin of the term in Hebrew. In Hebrew Bible, when you look, the term is Son of God is used like somebody that God loves. It's like, actually, according to Muhyiddin Arabi, it's like we say Halilullah for Prophet, like Ibrahim, like, or Habibullah. Like when you say Habibullah, someone God loves and elevates, it doesn't mean that person becomes divine. So Son of God might have used it in the very beginning in that sense. So Servetus noted this distinction, and therefore he opposed the doctrine of Trinity. So he's a beginning of anti-Trinitarian Christianity in that sense. And when he read the Quran, he said, well, Muhammad is our enemy, but some of the things you're saying are very actually interesting. And he quoted the Quran, and he said, maybe there's some truth in their teaching about us. That was one of the reasons he was burned at the stake, because, you know, Calvin said he's a Turkish spy, and Turks mean Ottoman at the time, and Muslims. So that was one of the reasons Servetus was killed. So my book also explains these kind of different bridges between Islam and Christianity, and shows heretical Christianity has some connection to the Islamic Christology that we have today. Now, in that sense, my book is a way to show that Islam's understanding of Jesus is not unfounded, you know, even from when you look from the Christian tradition. Christians can, of course, say, well, this is the doctrine, and God evolved this doctrine over time. We believe that. I have respect. I'm not criticizing Christianity in that sense. But I'm saying, hey, look, even in your different sects, there were Christian perspectives that actually were thinking like what we believe in the Quran. Am I talking too much? Should I? Just maybe 5 more minutes and finish that. Okay, but here's one more thing. Now, there are things that also we Muslims, I think, should learn about Jesus. Like, okay, we know the right things about Jesus, we claim that, right? But there's a reason why we should also think about Jesus. And that brings me to my final chapter in my book. That final chapter is titled, What Jesus Can Teach Muslims Today. Because we say Jesus is a prophet of God, he's a prophet of Islam, alhamdulillah, we are very proud. But what did we learn from Jesus, if he's a prophet? Should we learn anything from Jesus? Now, I get into that question in that chapter, and I say, yes, we should look into the teachings of Jesus, and it is important for us. Why do I make that argument? And I wrote a piece in the New York Times, which was published 3 days before about this. So you can read the argument there a little bit, but the more bigger details in the book. Here's what gave me that idea. Arnold Toynbee, the great historian of the 20th century, probably most of you have heard Arnold Toynbee. Arnold Toynbee wrote a very interesting article in 1948. Called Islam, the West, and the Future, in a book titled Civilizational Trial. Toynbee said, Islam once was a great civilization, very successful, very enlightened, but in the past century, it is in a crisis. It is going through tough times. And this crisis is a bit like the crisis of Jews under Roman domination in the first century. Why? Because Jews were monotheistic people. They had God's revelation, they had the true religion. But Rome, a pagan empire, came and dominated them, right? Rome occupied Palestine, put a Herod, a king that was collaborating with Rome, to suppress fellow Jews. Roman culture was very seductive, all the Roman baths and Roman majesty and everything. So Jews were being seduced by Roman culture. They were trying to live like the Romans. It was an attractive culture. MTV, of the day, if you like Hollywood, that was Rome. So Jews were really squeezed and threatened. So Toynbee says, this among Jews gave rise to two extreme reactions. One was the reaction of Herodianism. Herod was the Jewish king that collaborated with Rome and imitated the Roman ways. And the other one was zealotism, which is a fanatic fight with Rome. Like, there were Jewish zealots who tried to attack Roman soldiers. There were terrorism in modern day definitions. There were even attacking Jews who collaborated with Rome. So these were the Jewish revolutionaries. Reza thinks Jesus was one of those. I don't agree with him on that anyway. So these were two opposite reactions, but both are defined by Rome. You either imitate Rome and want to be like that, and you become like a hopeless fanatic fighter. Toynbee said in that article, that is the case of Muslim world in the modern era. You have Herodians who collaborate and imitate Rome, and he pointed to Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, you know, Turkey's secular founder. I hope the Turkish government won't put me in jail for that, for insulting Atatürk. We have laws like that in Turkey. And I would say Shah of Iran, especially the first one, and Habib Bourguiba in Tunisia. We had these kind of secular autocrats which really imposed the Western ways of life on us. These are the Herods of our time. And he said the zealots. He used the term Wahhabis, I don't want to blame all, of course, Saudis on this, but let's say the fundamentalists, some extreme Salafists. He just said the zealots of today, Muslims zealots, will be defeated because they can't use technology, he said. Had he seen, some zealots today using technology very well, he would be less optimistic about that. But anyway, Toynbee made this analogy, and I think it's a captivating analogy. Now, in that chapter, I asked, this is a good analogy, but let's say, if we are in a historical crisis, similar to the first century Jews in the face of Roman domination, what we Muslims should do? We should follow a prophetic motto, right? Prophetic teaching. Who's the prophet of the time? The prophet of the time is Jesus. Of course, our Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is always dear to us, and his model is always binding on us. But let's recall that Prophet Muhammad established a religion and brought it to success. That's a different context than what we are living today. Today we are living in a context where we have the religion for 14 centuries, but we are squeezed, we are crushed, we are frozen. We need some new openness. So we can take an idea from a different prophet. Like we take ideas from Moses in the face of Pharaoh, like Muslims refer to Moses all that. So I says, let's look at Jesus' teaching, if that's the context that we're living. And it's just not my idea. Muhammad Abduh made the argument, and I was really impressed by that in his 19th century, I know some Muslims fancy Muhammad Abduh, some don't, he was seen as too reformist. I like Muhammad Abduh and that kind of late 19th century kind of reformism in Islam, reform with a small r. Muhammad Abduh said, what Jesus said to the Jews of his time was really important. Because when you read the New Testament, which doesn't clash with the Quran in parts, he criticized Jews for being frozen on the literal meaning of the law while forgetting the moral purposes of the law. And Muhammad Abduh said, this is a problem we have today too. Some Muslims are looking into Sharia only literally, only dogmatically, without forgetting the maqasid, the intentions of Sharia. So if there's a Jesus perspective in the, under Roman attack and Herodian and zealot vicious cycle, it is to look into our religion by trying to discover its moral purposes and intentions, rather than being only blind literalists, and also who only obsess about external appearance while forgetting, the moral teachings of our religion. So in that sense, the Jesus teaching becomes a call for renewal in Islam. Renewal in the sense of discovering the moral teachings while understanding that sometimes blind literalism doesn't give you that exact result. So that's the final argument I have in the book. And I put so many things together and made a book, and but when you read it, it goes well, I'll tell you. Thank you so much for your attention.